C'est important de dire qu'aujourd'hui dans le monde, plus que la moitié de la population mondiale sont nés après 89. Donc, ce projet s'adresse à plus que la moitié de la population mondiale et évidemment à tous les autres.
L'idée de 89+, comme Hans Ulrich l'a décrit, était d'étudier la génération d'artistes, d'écrivains, de scientifiques, d'innovateurs, en un mot, qui sont nés en 89 et après, parce que 89, c'est l'année de la chute du mur de Berlin, de Tiananmen, du retrait des troupes soviétiques d'Afghanistan et bien d'autres événements politiques à l'échelle globale, mais aussi de l'introduction du World Wide Web par Tim Berners-Lee.
Chaque artiste a donc sa station et donc tous les quarts d'heure ils vont venir s'exprimer sur cette scène pour un peu plus expliquer ce qu'ils ont voulu faire pendant cette résidence. Et aussi nous aurons donc deux invités qui sont Édouard Louis et Boris Bergman pour aussi lier un peu donc ce projet à la scène locale parisienne. Voilà.
Vous êtes tous assis sur le dispositif, le display feature de Alessandro Barba. Un applause pour Alessandro.
The brief was to kind of imagine a workspace. So I was fascinated. I've been always fascinated by like the evolution of the workspace. And so I imagine that in the future, given you know wireless technology and all this kind of and technological developments, a workspace could just be a soft surface that you can lie on.
What I'd made in this residency was basically a research about the relationship that has like climate and social movements. So I made this research about all the explosions of the volcano Popocatépetl in Mexico since 1363 to now. So I realized that every explosion was related with a really important social change or a social movement or a political moment. So that was like the beginning of the project. And after that, I start like researching all the collective imaginary made by people that lives around volcanoes. So now I'm working with this imaginarium and all the pieces are related.
A lot of my work was hard to transport, so I'm using paper and drawing to communicate this idea of temporary spaces that are quite easy to transport for the neo-nomad. And in the residency, I worked on designing this component that had the ability to clip together and then pack back up for people who had the need to travel a lot, but needed a space that fit them instead of having them fit spaces around the world. I think that kind of sums up my work.
During my residency in Google, I create a collaboration with artists and researchers from Asia, which is from Malaysia, Philippines, and China, and Singapore. And basically, the project that I did is a 89-, because I'm trying to find and to investigate what happened before 89. And so because I come from Indonesia, I want to know what happened in Asia before 89. And so I took one important event in Asia, which is almost a little bit forgotten in history of Cold War. Mm-hmm. And it is the first Asian African conference. It happened in Bandung in 1955. And it was the birth of the Third World, where the Asian and African countries try together and try to find another alternative beyond the Eastern and the Western ideologies. So from there, I create a collective collaboration which try also to find what does it mean to create a new collective action in this digital world together in this shared immaterial platform in the internet. So that's what I do.
When I came to Google, what I wanted to do was give volume to sound a bit more, move it around space. And so what's happening here on the drone is that there's a radio on it and it's picking up the static electricity interference from the drone itself. So you're hearing the drone express itself. My relationship with the engineers was just talking to them about what were the potential kind of algorithms we could put on the drone to make it fly around the room and make it detect colors and what were the potential things that a drone could do. Yeah, basically, that sort of thing. So the great thing about the Google Residency is that so many different people come in every day into the Cultural Institute. So in my time there, I met people from fields as far as biology to the European Space Agency. And I got to sit down and talk with them and hear about their projects. And one of those people was Hikim, who runs a drone lab. And so I've been working in his hackerspace on the drone. He's been helping me with it, figuring out new things. Yeah.
My project started out loosely with the idea of machine translation and what sort of things could be mapped onto it, like these sort of figurative lines and where these figurative lines could come from. And more specifically, it also started with insects and with all of their crawling, what insects could write if they could write on an Android keyboard. So I started visiting the Entomological Society, or no, the Entomological Museum, and then the Association of Coleopterists that met there, and they were very kind and welcomed me to their meeting with a slideshow of beetle photos they had collected all over the world, one that I had to withhold. I was very tempted to show a slideshow of the very same images, but nonetheless, then they introduced me to a book written by a French civil engineer in 1910 named Victor Cornets. And in addition to studying the navigation of people living on the edges of the Sahara, he also studied the navigation of ants, and it was a book filled with his very charming ant drawings, going from their home to get food and back. And so I took these drawings and I mapped them out onto the Android keyboard in many different languages in a very gestural way. And you can see here in this ebook, also projected on the screen, the sort of prose that they had written, as well as translations done by Google's own Translate.
The two videos here, I really like to think of them as simulations of this, you know, this relationship that never was. I met my father through Facebook, and so the idea came, I guess it's originally, what brought me here was working on this project that I had, this idea that I had to make a copy of myself using my DNA. I had this idea that if you could sequence your DNA and then have a copy of that, however that sequence or code exists as, you could really consider that as a version of yourself. Maybe it's very basic articulation of are, but nonetheless, it is what you are. And that came from a series of conversations that I've been having with myself my whole life about the nature of reality, really.
What I did was, there's a jail in Portland, Oregon that was built 10 years ago. And as soon as they finished building it, they didn't have enough operation funds for the prison to become functional. So it's just remained empty for the last 10 years, but they do have a small janitorial staff that continues to clean it and maintain it.
And one of the staff is here, Jasper.
And one of the staff is here.
Can you show? Thank you, Rasmus.
Yeah, thank you.
Came straight from Portland.
Yes, he's wearing one of the custom uniforms. I made a body of sculpture and installed it inside the prison and documented it. I rented it for 10 days, but I selected the people who could come and actually see the sculptures in person, which was probably, I think it was only 10 people. And then I built a website for the documentation to exist there. And I also made a short video, which is playing right now. That is kind of an imagined narrative about the janitorial staff that cleans it.
Because I like to research about language, I try to focus on hand gesture, because hands are really the way we can make tangible, intangible things, especially artists. I mean, hands can build sculptures, drawings. That's why I wanted to focus on hands. And during the interview, I tried to get to know those people that I've never seen before. And And I try to really get to know them and extract from them how do they translate sadness and happiness. And during those moments, I divided those moments in frames, and I started to connect hand, right hand with left hand. And then I had a drawing made by my gesture about the other gesture and about their emotion. So you can see this is a happiness drawing. And you can see kind of a data visualization kind of thing, because when you compare all the sadness, all the drawings from all those different people from around the world, you can see kind of a pattern. Nothing scientific, but you can see kind of a pattern.
Or maybe I start like what I originally planned. Basically, I did this like series of shows, and I wanted to continue that. But then arriving in Paris and seeing the studio, like I kind of had like to adjust on what's happening here. I mean, of course, everything is kind of possible, but I really like the idea of being like limited to the studio that we had provided at Google, which is not like the studio that I normally work in, because it's more like in Paris, it's more like an office. So I changed the exhibition to something that is mainly produced on the laptop. So all I used was Gmail, basically, or like ordering stuff on Amazon, and like it all got delivered to the space, and basically I arrived, and then everything was done.